Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Hi. Ooh, lively today. I am Sarah Montgomery, and it is an honor to be your worship associate today. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Phoenix. Our called minister, Reverend Christine Dance, is away today at Unitarian Universalist General Assembly, and so I'm excited that my wife, London Montgomery, is giving our sermon. That's right. Woo! Montgomerys are taking over the pulpit. So a very special welcome to any of you who are joining us for the first time today. The Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Phoenix strives to be a spiritual community for our time, focused on diverse theological perspectives, radical inclusion, and knowing that issues of justice and equity shape everything we do. And a very special welcome to all of you joining us by Zoom, YouTube, and Facebook. Folks in the room, do you want to turn around and wave to people who are online? Remembering that we are one congregation, no matter how we are participating together today. Please join me as we recite our covenant. And maybe my daughter Hannah Montgomery and her friend Mary McManus will join us and light the chalice. Nope, just Mary. Hannah and Mary met at a worship associate get together, and they quickly became BFFs. So So they are hanging out today.
Lifers.
Yes. Love is the doctrine of this congregation. The quest for truth is our sacrament, and service is our prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to share our strength in fellowship, thus do we covenant.
Good morning, everyone. So among other exciting things happening in the world, today is Juneteenth, the holiday celebrating the end of legal slavery in the U.S. And yeah, finally, it's only our second as a federal holiday. London will be speaking today about the inspiration that she takes from a civil rights leader, Pauli Murray. And Murray was somebody who really didn't take no for an answer in their own life and work. They just kept growing and trying new things, no matter who stood in their way. So with that in mind, I want to open with a civil rights song of determination. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me round, turn me round. Turn me round, ain't gonna let nobody turn me round. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching on to freedom land. Ain't gonna let hatred, ain't gonna let no hatred turn me round. Well, turn me round, said turn me around. Ain't gonna let no hatred turn me around. We're gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching on to freedom land. Thank you. Ain't gonna let no fascists turn us around. Oh no, turn us around, no. Turn us around. Ain't gonna let no fascists turn us around. We're gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching on to freedom land. Ain't gonna let nobody turn us around, no, turn us around, Lord, turn us around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn us around. We're gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching on to freedom land. Thanks for the help, everyone. Appreciate it.
There is so much going on at UUCP, and you can find it all on our website, phoenixuu.org, and in our weekly newsletter, Compass. Next Sunday at 9:30 a.m. Arizona time, the General Assembly service. GA is the annual meeting of our Unitarian Universalist Association. Participants worship, witness, learn, connect, and make policy for the association through a democratic process. As we have done in the past, we'll invite our members to watch the GA service here. You are welcome to watch it from home or watch it on the big screen in the sanctuary. We'll have a Zoom meeting like usual for folks who want to watch from home but chat with each other. So remember, service next week is at 9:30 a.m. What time is service next week?
9:30.
Yes, all right. And because of the community level of COVID transition and the increase in the temperature that you might have noticed, we have to offer coffee-less coffee hour in the Johnson Room. So we'll have round tables set up where people can gather. We will not be serving food or drinks, so we keep masks on, and folks can gather there. So this is the last day to sign petitions at the back table. I think there are four of them. Thank you. Please see the civic engagement page of our website for links to sign up for early voting and to volunteer to help with cooling centers. Our offering is now a true share the plate every week. We split all undesignated funds 50-50 with a different organization each month because we feel that this approach reflects our values. For June, we are asking UUCP friends and members to share the Phoenix branch of the Bail Project. The Bail Project combats mass incarceration by disrupting the money bail system, one person at a time. UUCP donations will go to the Bail Project's revolving bail fund. The project restores presumption of innocence and challenges a system that criminalizes race and poverty. In fact, on average, judges set higher cash bail for Black and Brown people than for white people. The project is on a mission to end cash bail and create a more just and equitable pre-trial system. I want to share, this week, Hannah lost her very first tooth, and Tooth Fairy, the Tooth Fairy brought her $3, one to spend, one to share, and one to save. And when I asked her where she wanted to give her share dollar without missing a beat, Hannah said, UUCP. So I'm not suggesting that all of us give a third of our income to UUCP, but it's a good reference point. So to give, you can text UUCP-STP for share the plate to 73256. You can donate through the website, you can send a check, you can drop it off in the boxes at the front, which also have a QR code to scan. And if you're paying your pledge to UUCP, please indicate that on the check. For all that you give to our congregation and our community partners, we are so grateful.
I forgot to mention earlier to introduce myself. My name is Benji Messer. I'm the music director here at UUCP. And every June, UUCP holds a summer camp for kids. And so this whole building for 2 weeks now has been full during the week of happy kids and counselors. They've been playing games. They've been playing a lot of kind of running around sports games here in this sanctuary every day. There's been a lot of drumming, and this year they're making a movie as part of Kids Camp. So we have a video now of three youth in our congregation who are leaders in training, LIT, at this year's camp. And it ends with a trailer for the Kids Camp movie, which will be screened in our parking lot, drive-in style. You can tune your radio to the dial on Friday, July 1st at 8:30 p.m.
Camp's first inaugural camp drive. Sit in the air-conditioned comfort of your own car or bring a camp chair. Tune in to our movie broadcast over three weeks. Just come on the air conditioning experience with one of our limited bags. Just make sure you show up on time so you get a good spot. And you wouldn't want to get stuck on some big SUV.
experienced the most fascinating achievement in moving this side of the development of the state line. Our side of the hill park, no matter how many parallels it takes. Don't you go okay on those medium survivors? Just remember to roll backs. As it begins to be hard to understand, where you can choose from love, freedom, limited edition, deep flavor, arts and craft pop, developed by our very own leader, and in every class, as well as your questions. And just sit back and enjoy the production. Projected outside of our area, next year,
the time where we share the joys and sorrows of our community. Being together, it is good to share, to support each other and connect. Folks, Zoom, please feel free to add joys or sorrows into the chat and put them at the beginning. Those of you here in person, the joys and sorrows cards were at the front table if you want have something important to share. And I have one from you. I want to wish a happy Father's Day to anyone who identifies as a father, stepfather, or honorary dad. This is a day when we hold those men who have shaped us in our hearts. You might be missing someone today, thinking fondly of them, or holding mixed feelings. To all the dads, stepdads, and trans or non-binary mask parents joining us today, thank you for the patience, the love, the humor, and grace that you show those every single day. I know I've learned about parenting from the wonderful dad in this community. We have a joy from Devance, rain shower that Phoenix received yesterday. I think we've all appreciated that in the weather. Giving a moment for any joys or sorrows online. Folks in the sanctuary, let's hold up some hearts. People watching at home. Viewers on Zoom, feel free to turn on your cameras or react with a little heart. We're all here together.
And a happy Father's Day to my dad, too, who's watching on Zoom. Hey, y'all. And I now invite you to a time of meditation and prayer. Center yourselves, put your feet on your floor, if you wish, settle in place. As you take a few breaths in through your nose and out through your mouth, imagining a warm ball of light in the center of your chest, and with each breath in and out, feel that ball glow and that warmth stretch out through your whole body. Take a moment to feel that warmth within you. Let it grow with each breath. And with one last breath in, hold that energy within you more and out, releasing it back into the world. Amen. Blessed be. and Ashe.
So, last week we based our service on the song Sunday by Joy Aladokun. Like Pauli Murray was, Aladokun is queer and Black and incredible, and I've been listening to her music all week and sort of wanting to learn all her songs after learning that one for last week. So here's another. This one is about staying hopeful. It's called Look Up. Sometimes your life feels like a broken roller coaster, a thousand useless moving parts. Sometimes you spend your nights too scared of getting closer, hiding out in the backseat of your car. You tell yourself it's raining, the clouds are in your head. You tell yourself it's better to jump before you fall again, before you lose it all again. Look up, do you see the sunlight? Look up, there's flowers in your hair. Hold on, 'cause somebody loves you. You know trouble's always gonna be there. Don't let it bring you to your knees. Yeah, look up. Mondays aren't all bright, and some days you lose the fight, but life can be beautiful if you let it be. Tomorrow keeps taunting you with all kinds of mystery. It's a blank page for your poetry if you let it be. So don't tell yourself it's raining, the clouds are in your head. You tell yourself it's better to jump before you fall again, before you lose it all again. Look up, do you see the sunlight? Look up, there's flowers in your hair. Hold on, 'cause somebody loves you. You know trouble's always gonna be there. Don't let it bring you to your knees. Look up. Sometimes your life feels like a broken roller coaster, a thousand useless moving parts. Look up, do you see the sunlight? Look up, there's flowers in your hair. Hold on, 'cause somebody loves you. You know trouble's always gonna be there. Don't let it bring you to your knees. Yeah, look up. The trouble's always gonna be there. Look up. And don't let it bring you to your knees. Look up.
Picture the night sky. Each star represents one possible aspect of your personality, something that makes you, you. What stars are lit up for you? Maybe you like kayaking, cooking, or making spreadsheets. You might have stars lit up saying that you're introverted at school, but extroverted at Dungeons and Dragons. You have a unique arrangement of stars. There is nobody else on Earth with the exact same stars as you. Our culture or the patriarchy or whatever creates constellations. They say that girls should have stars lit up in this shape and stars need to fall in this constellation for boys. When somebody meets you, they make assumptions based on your appearance and identity. They expect these stars to be lit up and these other ones to be dark. We've all had that experience of a friend, a teacher, or a family member expecting us to have a star that just isn't lit up for us. In this family, we play football or we watch Jeopardy together. Someone might assume you can schlep heavy things or do arts and crafts or enjoy playing with kids. What can you do? You can try to fake it, pretend you like sports when you don't, or you can correct them. Either way, it's uncomfortable when somebody expects you to be someone you aren't. And I'm sure we've also had times when our stars have fallen outside the expected constellations. You're not supposed to like country music, or playing with dolls, or riding dirt bikes. You can try to dim those stars to fit in, just not mention to your coworkers how much you like RuPaul's Drag Race. But sometimes you can't help letting your star shine, and people will respond with surprise. You're so articulate, or you're not like other girls. It stings when we feel the weight of other assumptions. Hannah and I read It's Good to Be Yourself by Teresa Thorne, which talks about different gender identities and says that there are a million, billion different ways to be yourself in the world. And Hannah said, I'm sometimes girl, sometimes boy. I think on Mondays I'm a boy and the rest of the days I'm girl. I still use she. And yes, I got Hannah's consent to share that. Since none of us fit in this girl constellation or boy constellation, let's just make our own constellation where every single star can shine. How much brighter would this world be if each and every one of us could be true, whole, and unique selves?
Hi, all. Thank you so much for letting me be your guest once again. Back in September, I had the opportunity to share how I had been looking to find peace within myself, even when everything around me felt uncertain. I talked about how much this community means to my family, learning about accepting fear, letting go of the idea of fixing yourself. And I started with the four mantras given to me by my therapist, Dr. Misha Cohen-Peck. I am whole and complete. I am all be. I am worthy and I am lovable. No matter what outside stimulus, no matter what difficulty or hardship, or local, national, global tragedy is weighing on me, I can start with those four mantras. Something to hold on to that I can trust. And I can love myself. I can be witness to my own and celebrate it. And as June is Pride Month, I can also take pride in myself. Plus, it's a good excuse to clap my fan as loud as I want to. It's a little warm in here, and I highly encourage you to clap your fan as loud as you want to, too. Both figuratively and metaphorically, love yourself, forgive yourself when you can't, and be patient and kind with yourself as you build that peace within you. And so this is where, in the first draft of my sermon, I gave a list, a litany, all the awful things that have happened since that September. Examples of communities who have been hurt, terrible injustices, all from this wicked world, a world that is sad and afraid and not to be trusted. Want to be lamented, saved from. Fear is easy, pure. It's effective. Spirit invites us into individual groups, sorts us, and separates us. And I realized when I was writing from this fear within myself to say something like that from this position, used from up here, I was reminded it's a rhetorical device, one that I learned. This was the tool of my church growing up. Cautionary tales. Danger. Yeah, my original intent today was to show how small I felt over the past couple of months, but y'all don't need to be reminded how cold this world can feel. So instead, I'll have you take it on faith that it's been a rough couple of months, and I can imagine it's been pretty rough for y'all too. And I'm here for you. And my genuine hope is that today is a more joyful occasion. So what did I do? Well, I went back to Dr. Misha Cohen-Peck, of course. You know, maybe she had a secret fifth mantra for me. What she actually had me do was look up Pauli Murray. And do y'all know Pauli Murray? I didn't know Pauli Murray. You know Pauli. I've told you about Pauli Murray. I've talked about nothing but Pauli Murray for the past month. Anyway, I only have time up here to share a part of the book jacket of this person's extraordinary life, but I highly encourage you to look up the documentary My Name is Pauli Murray, or Pauli's own memoir, Song in a Weary Throat. In 1913, Pauli Murray was a kid who wanted to wear pants all the time, but was forced to wear a dress to church on Sundays. Later, through the Great Depression, they spent their youth riding the rails, passing masculine the whole time, going by names like Pete and The Dude. They literally went by The Dude. That is powerful, trans-masculine energy, far before the time when such terms were popularized. By the way, today the Pauli Murray Institute encourages they, he, and she pronouns to be used interchangeably when describing Pauli Murray to, quote, embrace the individual and fluid nature of gender. I like that very much. In 1938, Pauli Murray was rejected from the University of North Carolina because of the color of their skin. When they wrote to Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who just received an honorary degree to UNC, Pauli Murray received no reply. So they wrote to the First Lady, Eleanor Roosevelt, who did reply and said that the South was changing, but that Pauli shouldn't push too fast. So instead, Pauli Murray pursued a degree in law at Howard University so they may help change the laws that would deny access to higher education on the basis of race. Not later, but now. What? It's a rhetorical argument, kid. I'm just up here talking to everybody. In 1940, Pauli Murray was arrested for refusing to move to the segregated section of the bus. When Pauli told the guard that the cell was crawling with bed bugs, they were told, quiet, or I'll throw your ass in the dungeon. Upon release, they would write, as their senior paper, work that would be included in Plessy versus Ferguson 10 years later, overturning segregation and way for civil rights cases to come. Pauli Murray graduated at the top of their class at Howard, which meant automatic admittance into Harvard. Pauli Murray was denied access again, this time based on their gender. So they went to UC Berkeley instead, and then to Yale for their doctorate. Yale would then go on to open the Pauli Murray College. You can attend there now. It opened in 2016. But back in 1940, no law firm would take a black female attorney, and even one with multiple degrees in law. So instead, Pauli Murray set up their own law firm. One day in court, they represented a sex worker, and an eyewitness for the prosecution identified Pauli not as legal counsel, but as the prostitute they claimed to see performing a crime. Because how could somebody who looks like Pauli Murray possibly be a lawyer? That didn't deter them. In 1961, they would help found the National Organization of Women and ensure that demands for equal protection of law extended both to race and gender, a radical idea at the time. And in 1973, when Pauli Murray's longtime partner, Eileen Barlow, died of cancer, they had no way of expressing to her friends and loved ones what their relationship meant. as history so often erases queer relationships, Pauli was seen by friends and loved ones and writers only as losing a friend, a close friend. So that tore them up. But then, while Pauli Murray was searching for an answer, they found that they needed a better spiritual understanding of life and beyond, and that search led them to become the first African-American Episcopalian priest, who was later sainted in 2012. So why did my doc send me to Pauli Murray? Well, because when Pauli Murray saw the injustice in the world, they realized, quote, I needed a weapon. I needed a skill. Which is the advice I share with you today. When you leave today, go home, stop everything you're doing, become a lawyer, a priest, and go fix the world. Also become a poet and a professor. I mentioned she wrote poems, right? And was tenured at Brandeis. All right, good. Just do all that, and you're going to be great. You're missed and everything. But I don't think that's actually what my doc had in mind, because what I actually got from discovering this impossible person is a reminder that pain doesn't have to define. To remind me that everyone has the ability to affect positive change in the world in multiple ways, that we can learn new things and grow and adapt, learn new skills at any stage in your life, and that the work that we do counts. No matter how big the adversary, no matter how deeply entrenched the injustice, the work that we do can lead to lasting and powerful change for good, both in history and today. And I need to be reminded of that. Because in hindsight, I've spent a lot of life trying to find both an identity and a helpful way of looking at my brain, and for a long time, I didn't have a good answer. You know, you go into therapy, you expect to be asked about your childhood. And the truth is, I had it great growing up. Hi again to Dad and Mom, who's both listening on Zoom. I was really lucky to get to grow up as I did. And I am so grateful for everything that my mom has given to me. I just didn't know some really important things about myself. Dr. Peck challenged me to look back on my childhood and wonder what a younger London would think of me today. They didn't have the language, the understanding of myself. Would they hate me? Would they recognize me? Would I scare them? Thank you. And all I want to do is go back and help that kid and let them know that just because they don't they couldn't parse their feelings, that those feelings were still real, and they didn't have to hurt, and that it eventually gets so much better. Through our work together, my doctor taught me that I don't need to define myself by the pain that I couldn't describe, that instead of spiraling around what if, I could instead be grateful to my younger self for continuing to move forward, for the work they did to get me here. And this was a tough one, that I could consider myself courageous, which I've always fought back on, because how could I be courageous just for surviving? And through a lot of work, I figured out that answer was yes. That is important. It counts. I stuck with it. And I figured out how to love myself, and I got myself on the right medication. And that could be hard. See? So, no matter what your situation today, don't lose hope. Hopelessness is an intentional tool. We're taught that the walls are too tall, that the problems are too big. It's a tool wielded against us to keep us quiet and easy, and pride is a loud celebration. It's a riot, an opportunity to remember those whose work brought us this far, and I'm so grateful to Pauli Murray, to Marsha P. Johnson, to Sylvia Rivera, to Reed Erickson, and Janet Mock, and the countless other trans and gender expansive activists that have made my life as it is today possible. This month, we celebrate the radical idea that you can be proud of who you are today. Imperfect and beautiful, proud of your strength, proud of the work you've accomplished and proud of the work you'll do today and tomorrow, because you can do that work. Maybe not like three whole law degrees, Pauli Murray, wild, but still. We have the best chance ever today to make life better for the people that we love, and that's because of the work that comes before us. Plus, I truly believe that we have access to better communication, better information. It's getting much harder to erase history these days. And only through other queer and neurodivergent stories was I able to find myself. And it is my sincere hope that I get to continue sharing that message to everyone I can. And again, thank you so much for letting me be here today. We can share our experiences now, and we can share our victories loudly and joyfully. For example, this year, Equality Texas ensured that over 30 anti-LGBTQ bills lobbied in Texas were thrown out. That's all of them, by the way. Youth sports bans, defeated. Taking away healthcare from trans youth, defeated. Making it illegal to change your ID, defeated. In Texas. It's incredible. Here's another. Moms Demand Action, the largest volunteer group promoting gun control in America, now has over 8 million supporters, 121 of whom right now are running for offices across the country. Every Town for Gun Safety is spending millions of dollars to educate, train, and mentor candidates at local, state, and federal levels. That's incredible. Last weekend, I laughed with my wife so hard we cried. Over nothing. And Julie Garden, and skincare protocol, and all the years we've loved each other and everything. My therapist gave me one more mantra. That's right, there was a secret fifth mantra. Mind blowing. I'm whole and complete. I'm all I need to be. I'm worthy. I am lovable, and I matter. I came to tell you that last one, because it's true, you matter. The work you do on yourself is worth your time, and from there, you're strong enough to learn something new, to enact meaningful change in the world, and to take pride in what you've accomplished. Remember that no one person can do everything, except for Pauli Murray, who kinda did. But if you're like me and you haven't been sainted by the Episcopalian Church yet, don't sweat it. Just remember that these walls around us have been around us for a long time. Our work today, while different, is not new, and change has always been possible. And hope continues to live. And even in times and places where love is forbidden and unspoken, it exists, and that while we are unique, we are not alone.
London, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Some of you may not know, London and Sarah and Hannah are moving out of Phoenix soon. I know. So I just, having you offer this service together is such a gift to us as a congregation. And it's been so wonderful having you in the congregation for so many years, and we are gonna miss you. Yeah. So to close, Sarah's offered to sing a song about gender and acceptance and telling the truth about ourselves. The lyrics go by pretty quick. We'll put them on the screen for you. This is When I Was a Boy by Dar Williams. And it's going to take me a minute to start because I have to retune the guitar. She uses a funny tuning.
At our wedding, I asked my sister to sing a song by the Beatles. What was it?
I have no idea.
Okay, and because of snafus, she ended up having to sing it right after our vows and just was all teary and weepy. And so I appreciate this little reprieve between London's sermon and my singing. It was I Will by the Beatles. Who knows how long I've loved you? You know I always will. Dad's used to teach acoustic guitar or classical guitar, and he always say, "We tune because we care." You're welcome. I won't forget when Peter Pan came to my house, took my hand. I said I was a boy, I'm glad he didn't check. I learned to fly, I learned to fight. I lived a whole life in one night. We saved each other's lives out on the pirate deck. And I remember that night when leaving out late night with some friends, and I hear somebody tell me it's not safe, someone should help me. I need to find a nice man to walk me home. When I was a boy, I scared the pants off of my mom, climbed what I could climb upon. And I don't know how I survived. I guess I knew the tricks that all boys knew. Can walk me home, but I was a boy too. I was a kid that she would like, just a small boy on her bike, riding topless, yeah, I never cared who saw. My neighbor came outside to say, "Get your shirt." I said, "No way, it's the last time, I'm not breaking any law." And now I'm in this clothing store, and the signs say less is more. More that's tight means more to see, more for them, not more for me. And that can't help me climb a tree in 10 seconds flat. When I was a boy, see that picture, that was me. Grass-stained shirt and dusty knees. Now I know things have gotta change. They got pills to sell, they got implants to put in, they got implants to remove. I am not forgetting that I was a boy too. And like the woods where I would creep, it's a secret I can keep, except when I'm tired, except when I'm being caught off guard. Had a lonesome, awful day. Conversation finds its way to catching fireflies out in the backyard. And so I tell the man I'm with about the other life I've lived. And I say, "Now you're Top Gun. I have lost and you have won." And he says, "Oh no, no, can't you see? When I was a girl, Mom and I, we always talked, and I picked flowers everywhere that I walked. And I could always cry, now even when I'm alone, I seldom do. I have lost some kindness, like you.
Y'all sounded so good. As we've done for the last 2 years, we will have online coffee hour immediately following service. It is a separate link found in the chat on the website and Compass or on the final slide. We will also have air-conditioned but coffee-less coffee hour in the Johnson Room. The Johnson Room is out the doors to your left, across the patio to the left, or you can follow folks down the hall. Coffee table talk is online in person. Excellent. And then I could just go down to the closing words. And then we can close this thing out and let people out here. I should probably do that now, right? Okay. Go in peace. Love. Happy Pride.